feet down here. Right up here.
Yeah.
high five?
We have available chairs, so please come sit. Firefighters, law enforcement, EMTs, welcome. Thank you so much. But please sit. We're going to start our program. We welcome you all, but we'll start it off with the invocation, which is led by the VFW Auxiliary Chairperson, Elsie Kiefer.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray today to remember one of the most tragic days in the history of the United States. So many lives were lost those 20 years ago. We pray for lives lost and families left behind. Heavenly Father, commit us to thy tender mercy and care. May the grace, mercy, peace, and blessing of God the Father be with each and every one of us. In his name, amen.
Next, we're going to welcome Deputy Ortlib from Lewis County Sheriff's Department, Jamie from Search and Rescue, and Mike Tabalt from New Bremen Fire Department, to raise and lower our flag to half staff. Folks.
Detail, attend, first. Present, first.
Attention as Mrs. Kiefer leads us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome you all, and we have a warm welcome from our commander of the VFW, Dennis Everson, commander of the VFW.
Thank you, everyone, for coming. Show respect for the people who died on 9/11. And welcome to our annual commemoration. This is the second one we've done. We'll probably do this every year from now on. So I'd like to say God bless everybody and God bless our first responders. Thank you.
Thanks, Commander. We're a little bit ahead of schedule. Captain Tennis, do you want to jump in? At 8:46, we will take the minute of pause, but I'm looking at it being 8:36 right now. So let me introduce to you Captain Robert Tennis. Maybe you saw him on TV last night. He's a busy man this time of year. Has worked as a firefighter for the federal government for 31 and a half years. Retired in 2019 from Fort Drum. I knew Bob then. We worked for the same directorate. But when I was looking for someone that knew firsthand what happened at 9/11, on 9/11, and deployed to Ground Zero, Captain Tennis' name came up. So he graciously agreed to come greet us today. If we need to take the pause, we'll take the pause at that time, but please be seated. Thanks.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor and privilege for me to be here with you today. The 20th anniversary of our great country being attacked. And a special thank you to Randa for asking me to come here and speak with all of you today. As the fire trucks were arriving, they were playing Alan Jackson's song, "Where Were You When the World Stopped Turning?" I can hardly remember 3 days ago, and you can ask my wife, if I don't take a list to Walmart, I come home with the wrong stuff. But I can tell you almost everything that happened September 11, 2001. I was on duty at Fort Drum. We were in a training class doing hazardous material training. The phone rang. The firefighter on duty and dispatch said, "You need to turn the television on." So we turned the television on after the first plane hit the tower. So as we were talking as firefighters, we were thinking, what an unfortunate accident that just happened. So if you know our training officer at the time, Eddie Bush, he's like, "All right, we ain't got time for this. Let's get back to training." And then they continued to watch on the television, and the second plane hit the towers. So then training stopped, and we were sitting there, and we knew that our country was under attack. We didn't know what was going to be next. But as firefighters, we were talking about what we would do if we were there, what they are doing while they're there. We talked about size up. How do you even start with size up for 210-foot towers? How do you do fire attack? How do you do rescue? They did it, and they did it well. So the day went on. Still, Fort Drum went into lockdown because we, you know, the country was under attack and we didn't know what was going to happen next. So later that evening, I received two phone calls. One from Guilfoyle Ambulance, where I worked part-time, asking me if I wanted to go to Ground Zero, and I said absolutely. And the next was from my mother. Telling me my father had lung cancer. So this day means a tremendous amount to me. So then within the next 36 hours, I left for New York City. We bailed into two ambulances and off we went for the 6-hour journey to New York. I was nervous, anxious, excited to help. I felt a sense of pride and a sense of duty. We got to New York City and we had to report to staging. And I can't tell you how many volunteers from out the state of New York and the country that were there to help. So the hours went by, and then finally it was our turn. We hit the top of the list to get our assignment, and that was ground zero. So as we headed down to the lower end of Manhattan, we had to stop at one of the barriers. So as we stopped, there was people clapping and applauding and saying thank you, hugging us and giving us bottles of water, masks, and they were just really appreciative of the fact that we were there to help them. Then as I crossed through the barrier, there was nothing. There was no traffic on the roads. There was no people talking. There was no noise except for the ambulances going down the road. The streets were covered in dust and debris. Briefcases and clothes were just left on the side of the road as the people just left it to run for their lives. Then we finally arrived at ground zero. You could smell the fire still burning. You could see the smoke coming from the subways. And I haven't even seen ground zero yet. Streets still covered in debris. Fire escapes stuffed with debris. Then there was my walk down Liberty Street. They had taken all the storefronts and they turned them into makeshift hardware stores. So if a construction worker or a firefighter needed a tool, that's where they went to get it. Then I turned the corner for my first sight at the pile. My first reaction was shock. My mind could not comprehend what I was seeing. Mass destruction. The sight of it, the smell of it, so surreal and incredibly sad all at the same time. But as I looked around, I saw the faces. I looked in the faces of everyone working on the pile. They dug with their hands and put all the debris into buckets, 5-gallon buckets, so they could be sifted bit by bit, piece by piece. I saw the humanity in all of them, working tirelessly. I can't imagine how many hours they've spent on the pile, but no one quit. There was a job to be done and they were going to do it. The piles of steel were, I can't even tell you how high. As I said, there's debris and fire escapes. And I saw one building that looked like a stick of butter that a hot knife had sliced right through the center of it. But then it's what I didn't see. You had 210-story office buildings. There were no desks. There were no telephones. There was no file cabinets. There was nothing. It had all been disintegrated as the towers came down. We were only there for a short while. It was 6 to 8 hours because there were so many volunteers. They just wanted to change out the crews and keep them fresh at ground zero. So we were off. Our ride home was completely different than the ride down. We sat in silence for a long time. We were thankful for being alive, and we were thankful for the opportunity to go and serve, and we were all changed forever because of it. I'd like to leave this with you today. How do we honor the memory of those lost that day, and the soldiers and the sailors who have made the ultimate sacrifice for us since? And again, I'm going to go back to Alan Jackson's song. He says, "But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some great things he gave us, and the greatest is love. So love your neighbor more than yourself. That's how we're going to honor them today. Thank you very much.
We've got 1 minute to our techie, our quartermaster, Sean Thornton. So if you all will get ready to reflect at 8:46 where you were and what was going on when that first plane struck, we all remember and we'll never forget. And that is the theme. We remember, and happy to have a World War II veteran, Harold Englehart, on our banner. His great-grandson, really great, Hunter Petrus, and Kenny Kiefer, a Korean vet. So thank you for being our banner carriers. Appreciate it. Sean? Please be seated. There it goes again. Just a few things to remember about that day. We lost that day nearly 3,000 first responders. I think it was 343 firefighters on that day, and many since. And if anyone saw the news last night about Captain Lochnauer from Watertown, he was a victim of 9/11 many years later. And there's many, many others that have died from respiratory problems and cancer. And then even beyond that, if you think of it, what precipitated the global war on terror and the lives that have been lost in both Afghanistan and Iraq. And we pray that that's all over, and that continues. One of our main concerns here is a program to prevent veteran suicide. Many of those are victims of PTSD and just can't get the help they need, so they take their life. That's often as a result also of 9/11. We've lost 12,000 killed in Iraq and Afghanistan, 32,000 have been injured, and an untold number of deaths that haven't been attributed to it. We honor today firefighters, law enforcement, search and rescue crews, and I just wanted to mention one more faction that is often forgotten, and that's the dispatchers. And I say that because of personal interest with a daughter-in-law that dispatches here, but imagine being a dispatcher in New York City 20 years ago. Imagine what they went through. So they are also first responders. They're kind of the first responders. You just don't see them. Down at Lowville Academy today, Lowville Fire Department is conducting a climathon. It is firemen in full turnout gear, climbing three stories, is that right, Chief Austin? Three stories. The benefit is to the Fallen Firefighters Fund and also to the local fire department. I heard something the other day that I really hadn't thought about before, and that is Lewis County is the only county in New York State that does not have a paid department. Never really thought about that. So what does that mean? That means that through a lot of fundraising, they're able to sustain themselves, keep equipment current, training current, and do the right thing. So what we're doing today, we're giving, normally you give a guest Krogan bologna and cheese. Instead, we're giving Captain Tennis a card with a check. To go in the bucket. Thank you. This will be out for everyone also. The other thing is, this is going to Lowville, but support your own local fire department and all their fundraising efforts. It's just a tremendous job they all do. And we all know we have to fight for every penny, but we do that. I want to thank Stewart's here in Lowville for a donation of donuts, and also Miller's Meat Market for the same. Great people, and we're fortunate to be part of their community. We're going to close now with a benediction, also by Mrs. Kiefer.
I was watching television that day. And when that airplane hit the building, I called a friend and said, there's been an accident. That's what I thought it was. And then the second one hit, and I knew it was something. And I'll never forget. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the first responders across the nation. Be with them as they put themselves in harm's way to keep us safe. Please give them your wisdom and discernment to know how to respond amid challenging situations. Send your angels to watch over and protect them. May they return safely to their families at the end of their shift. Please guard their heart and mind against the stress and anxiety their job presents them each day. Amen.
Can't read with that, son. You're not complaining, Elsie. It could be raining. We invite you all inside. If you would go to the second door of the ramp, and then we have coffee and donuts available. Again, donated, so munch them down. They're really good. Please join us inside, and thank you all.
Again, please join us inside. Thank you also to the Legion Color Guard. I appreciate you being here. Thanks again. And also Dan Ortlieb, wherever you are, you're a great guy. I couldn't do it without you.